Hello. Okay, we're in Isaiah 54. Last time we covered Isaiah 53. So the caption for Isaiah 54 is Perpetual Covenant of Peace. Before I get into the verses here, the last chapter in Isaiah, he told us about the sufferings of Christ, and it's fitting that it was in Isaiah 53 because in this chapter he describes the life of the church and that's what we are going to be going over here. So, at the end of 53, it was promised to Christ that he should see his seed. All right. We know that the church is his seed. So, this chapter tells us about that promise that he should see a seed. And it's fitting that it goes right into his seed in chapter 54. It can easily be granted that this can be applied to the Jewish church. After they returned out of Babylon, which through Christ we have been grafted into the Jewish church, right? So, with Isaiah, we all know that a lot of his writings had a near and a far application. All right, so the near application would be this would apply to the Jewish church right away when Isaiah was writing this out of Babylon. So earlier in Isaiah, we covered the Jewish promises to to Israel, okay, in chapter 44. Although it applies here and it's a dual near and far, we're going to cover the church's promises out of this. So we're going to cover the far aspect from this instead of the near, because we already covered that in chapter 44. So that's what we're going to do today. And because we're the church, so the near application already happened. We're looking to what affects us since we already studied the history of it. Okay, so it can't be denied, you know, that it does fit for the Jewish church as well that we're grafted into. But we're going to cover the church here. Christ's bride is who we're going to cover. So, the church in which the Gentiles were admitted. So let's see. A lot of my studying today came from Matthew Henry. It also, I use Chuck Smith and Chuck Missler commentaries as well. I always use them, but I used Matthew Henry for this because some of this was hard to wrap my head around. So, all right, verse one. Seeing, O barren, you who have not borne, break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not labored with child, for more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married woman, says the Lord. So right away, if you think about this, you know that this is not Israel. This cannot be Israel because Christ came out of Israel. She bore Christ. So we're going to go to Galatians 4:26. And it's going to explain, it's the key to this verse. And it says, Galatians 4:26, but the Jerusalem above is free, which is the mother of us all. 27. And then it quotes this verse. For it is written, Rejoice, O barren, who did not bear, break forth and shout, you who do not and who are not in labor, for the desolate has many more children than she who has a husband. All right, so, and then 28 says, Now we, brethren, as Isaac are the children of the promise. Okay, so Galatians is the key to interpreting Isaiah 54, which is one of the reasons that I had to go to Matthew Henry to interpret this, but. So Paul explains to us in Galatians that these promises are concerning the Christian church. So, like everything else, has a near and far application. Okay, so the near was the promise to the 42,000 Babylonian people that were in Babylonian captivity that came out of Babylon and went back to the ruins of Jerusalem. So that was the near promise. All right. And so the far is what we're getting ready to go over. So God And still in verse 1, God is the husband to the Jewish people, his chosen people, right? She is married to him. Out of her came his son, Jesus Christ. So she bore Jesus Christ as the wife to God. So Israel is not barren. The Gentiles were barren. So this is saying break forth into singing, talking about the church. More are the children of the desolate equals the multitudes that were converted from idols to the living God. So it's no secret that in the Old Testament, the Gentiles worshipped idols. So there were more good people found in the Gentile church than ever had been found in the Jewish church. God's sealed remnant from the tribes of Israel are just that, a remnant compared to the thousands of Israel. All right. So verse 2, enlarge the place of your tent and let them stretch out the curtains of your dwellings. Do not spare, lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes. So the bounds of the church is what verse 2 is going over. And the church boundaries were extended further than ever before. It was the business of the apostles to disciple all the nations, to stretch forth the curtains of the church and preach the gospel where Christ had not yet been named. All right, so that was their job. You can read more about that in Romans 15, 20. Verse 3, for you shall expand to the right and to the left, and your descendants will inherit the nations and make the desolate cities inhabited. All right, so what they're talking about, Eastern and Western churches here, and basically what it's saying is when they're calling these cities desolate, they're calling them desolate from the knowledge of God, the true God, okay? So in Romans 19, 20, can read more about this, but it's where the gospel is spread to all parts of the world. The cities desolate were desolate of knowledge and worship of the true God, all right? Verse 4. Do not fear, for you will not be ashamed, neither be disgraced, for you will not be put to shame, for you will forget the shame of your youth, and you will not remember the reproach of your widowhood anymore. All right, so as the Gentile nations, before we were grafted in, we were not the bride. We were not yet the bride. Christ hadn't done what he needed to do. So we were grafted in through Christ. So there was a reproach of Christianity at the beginning in its youth, and that's what this is talking about. Verse 5, for your maker is your husband, the Lord of hosts is his name, and your redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. He is called the God of the whole earth. Love that. All right. So Christ made the church, and he is our kinsman redeemer. Been over that before in these studies, okay? If you've done anything else with me in Isaiah, I mention it several times. He is our Goel. He is our kinsman redeemer. He had to be akin of us, so he had to become human and be God to redeem us, to save us from our sin, okay? And through the laws of spirituality, there are certain laws and the realm, the holy realms, he had to become akin to us to save us. He is the only human in heaven. There is a man in heaven, and it's Jesus Christ, okay? So, he is our kinsman redeemer. We are not widowed anymore and betrothed to him, waiting for him to come back for his bride, the church, okay? So, his redemption saved us from the bondage of sin, the worst of slaveries. He is and shall be called the Lord of the whole earth, right? And John 1, chapter 1, 1 through 5 goes over that. So, when Christ shed his blood for us, the partition wall between the Jew and Gentile was removed, grafting us into the Jewish promises, okay? So remember when the curtain tore at the temple when Christ died, so on the cross. So when that happened, at that moment, the division was removed. The curtain separated the Holy of Holies, if you remember, and from everything else. So that curtain wasn't didn't need to be there anymore. So it tore. It was removed. There was no need for it because God's Spirit could dwell with us and in us and didn't have to dwell behind the curtain because he couldn't look upon sin. And Jesus Christ was the bridge for that. He could not look at us. There had to be the Holy of Holies before he could dwell in us because he could not look upon our sin. When we are covered in Christ's blood, he sees his Son in us and he can look at us through his Son, but not if we don't have his Son, he cannot, because he cannot look upon sin. All right, so we as Gentiles, this is verse 6. For the Lord has called you like a woman forsaken and grieved in spirit, like a youthful wife when you were refused, says your God. So we as Gentiles, not Jews, were grafted in. We were not always a part of God's promises, all right? Like a woman forsaken and grieved in spirit. So I have a reference here. The Gentile woman who begged Jesus to cast a demon out of her daughter. I don't know if you remember that or not. It was in Mark 7. We'll go over that. I'll just read it. Okay, Mark 7:26. The woman was a Greek and Syro-Phoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. So if you notice, it tells you her nationality, ethnicity. She's a Greek Syro-Phoenician. She's not a Jew, okay? So she comes to Jesus, asking him to cast a demon out of her daughter. 27, but Jesus said to her, let the children be filled first, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And verse 28, she said and answered and said to him, yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs. 29, then he said to her, for this saying, go your way, the demon has gone out of your daughter. 30, and when she had come to her house, she found that the demon gone out of her daughter lying on the bed. All right, so he cast a demon out of her daughter. So his response is because he had to preach to the Jewish people first. That's what he came for. So he came to save all, but he had to preach to them first. And that's what this is all talking about. So her faith is what got her daughter healed. So his response meant that he had to preach to the Jew first, then the Gentile. All right. So after his death, this was no more. So we were forsaken and refused before Christ died to save us. So the Jewish people are his chosen people, but before Christ died, we were doomed, okay, as Gentiles. But he came for us as well. Our promise for redemption as the church in Christ's seed. And that's what this chapter is all about. So, verse 8. With a little wrath, I hid my face from you for a moment. I think I skipped it. Yeah, I skipped verse 7. So, verse 7 says, for a mere moment I have forsaken you, but with great mercies I will gather you. And that's what that was all talking about, is that we weren't always saved. We were grafted in. Jesus died for us to save us, but we weren't always under God's grace, okay, and his mercy. All right, verse 8. With a little wrath, I hid my face from you for a moment, but with everlasting kindness, I will have mercy on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. A little wrath, and he hid his face. Before getting grafted in, before Christ, Gentile nations, they worshiped idols. We all know this. They mention them in the Old Testament. And they were susceptible to God's wrath through the ages because they did worship idols, okay? So that's what he's talking about. With a little wrath, I hid my face from you for a moment. So that's what this verse is talking about. Verse 9, for this is like the waters of Noah to me. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah would no longer cover the earth, so I have sworn that I would not be angry with you nor rebuke you. So what he's saying is that because he hid his face for a moment, but with everlasting kindness, he had mercy on us. Our Redeemer, okay, in verse 7, and then, or verse 8, And then verse 9, he says that his covenant with us, his promise to us, will be like the promise of the waters of Noah to him. Okay. How he promised that he would never flood the earth again by water. That's like his covenant with this, with us is. That's what this verse is saying. So, that his anger and rebuke should not fall on us anymore. It's a covenant. And I have a note here that says, this is an eye-opener. The grace and mercy Jesus shed on us by saving us. This is, he saved us from a life of eternity and torment. We were grafted in because of him. So it's a big eye-opener of his sacrifice and what he did. Okay. Verse 10. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from you, nor shall my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord, who has mercy on you. This is awesome. Because it says in Habakkuk 3:6, it talks about the mountains are referred to everlasting and the hills are referred to as perpetual. So the mountains and hills are perpetual and everlasting, okay? And God's talking about, so what he's saying is that even if these were removed, his kindness and his covenant would not be removed from us. So awesome, awesome promise. So verse 11, O you afflicted one, tossed in tempest and not comforted, behold, I will lay your stones with colorful gems and lay your foundations with sapphires. So these are the promises still that God not only love us and his people, but the church would rise in greater prosperity than ever before. So that's what this is talking about. Previous chapter, we went over the humiliation of Christ, but we as the church who pick up our cross and suffer with him, we shall reign with him also. Again, this is the far outlook, of course. So he's talking about here the stones and the colorful gems. Our foundations are with him, all right? And he will reward us for our sufferings with Christ. Precious stones cannot be burned up like hay or straw or wood. So we're speaking in terms of the Holy Spirit, and Jesus is our foundation, okay? So 1 Corinthians 3:10 through 15 covers that. Okay. 12 and 13. I will make your pinnacles of rubies, your gates of crystal, and all your walls of precious stones. All your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. So, again, with the precious stones, this is a reference to the children being brought up in the church, okay? It's saying, all your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. Right. Peace is an underestimated thing. So you don't realize how important and how important, I can't even think of a good word right now to describe it, but until you don't have peace, you don't realize how important it is. I can't think of another word, but it's just... until your peace is gone, you just really don't understand. Don't understand. Okay, 14. In righteousness you shall be established. You shall be far from oppression. You shall not fear and from terror, for it shall not come near you. So these words are very important, especially today, in what we as the church face. All right. Great fear can fall on people when the rod of the government is turned into the serpent of oppression. So I got that from Matthew Henry. And that is couldn't be more fitting than what is going on with us today. So the Holy Spirit is a restrainer, as you know, and he's restraining things right now in the world. But he won't always be restraining things in the world. So when we're raptured, the Holy Spirit will be removed, and there will be nothing to restrain these forces of evil anymore. So you can only imagine what's going to happen. Actually, we know what's going to happen because the Bible tells us what's going to happen. We don't want to be here. So, all right, verse 15. Indeed, they shall surely assemble, but not because of me. Whoever assembles against you shall fall for your sake. Okay, these last three verses are my favorites. I love them because what a promise. These are great promises. So it says they will assemble against you, okay, against us, the church, because of him, but not by God's order. He's not telling them to assemble because of us. They will assemble because of who we love, because he is our God. So, and it says their attempt will end in their own ruin. All right. So Psalms 27:2 goes over this as well. And then in 54:16, behold, I have created the blacksmith who blows the coals in the fire, who brings forth an instrument for his work, and I have created the spoiler to destroy. It took me some studying to figure out what this meant. So I wrote it down here. So what God is talking about here is that they have no power but what is given to them from him. So he created the blacksmith. He gave them their power, and he can limit and restrain them. So basically God is saying that he's in control. He made them, so he can controls what they do with what he made them to do. So example, they can't carry out their plans without arms and weapons of war. So the blacksmith with the coals and the fire, he makes these instruments for war, and created to spoil and destroy, but he can't use them if God has a hand on him. See, God controls what he lets him use these weapons, lets him make these weapons. He can't do anything without God. So they can't carry out their plans without arms and weapons of war. And God made the blacksmith who makes these weapons. So, and he can tie his hands so that the project of the enemy shall miscarry and be thwarted. Okay, God's control. He controls everything. He controls them. He controls absolutely everything. And that's something here recently that I've had to remind myself in my life, is that he is in control of my life. He's in control of everything. Absolutely everything. My health, my mental state, my finances, my marriage, everything. God is in control. And I have to remind myself of that, because when God's in control, that means there is nothing to worry about. And that brings a lot of peace. All right. The spoiler to destroy, that's a military reference. All right. So God made men, and in order for a military to be a force, it must have soldiers. So, and the soldiers God created and placed where they are. Okay. So that was their journey in life, was to be in the military. So not only can he restrain them, he can serve his own purposes and designs for them, even if they're for the other team, okay, for the side of evil. All right, last verse, verse 17. And everybody knows this verse. This is very popular. But I think the sad part is that they forget the rest of it. So they say, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. And then they just stop there. But I think the best part is at the end, okay? It's the rest of it. That's the best part. So it says, 54:17, no weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue which rises against you in judgment you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord. I love that. Our righteousness comes from him. And every tongue which rises against us in judgment we shall condemn. Our heritage is in the Lord, the people who serve the Lord, us. Okay? Our heritage is with him. He is our inheritance. I love that. Absolutely love that. And again, this refers back to the blacksmith. Okay, so no weapon formed against us shall prosper, because guess what? God made the blacksmith who made the weapon, and he controls it. So that's what these are talking about. God is in control. Let me see what I have written as a note here. that our righteousness is from him. That means we are protected and cannot be condemned. And God made us righteous through Jesus Christ, his son, that cleansed us of our sin and made us righteous before him. Our inheritance is with him. So that finishes up Isaiah 54. And I will see you next time for Isaiah 55.